This is the Redmi Note 9 4G, Redmi's new starter Redmi Note 9 for China. Now, we've seen the Redmi Note 9 series launch in India already. The Redmi Note 9 Pro and the Pro Max came first, and then the Redmi Note 9 also launched. But this Redmi Note 9 4G is very different. So, what are the differences? What has Redmi actually done? Is this any kind of upgrade over the Redmi Note 9 selling in India? Well, let's take a not so exclusive look at Redmi's new Redmi Note 9 4G. Hey guys, Ash here from C4E Tech, and if you do end up liking what you see in this video, please don't forget to turn on notifications by hitting that bell icon. Let's now get started. So here is the Redmi Note 9's box. It's pretty simplistic. The white and gradient purple blue hue, they kind of meld well together. The 6000 mAh mentioned up top, and this is one of the Redmi Note 9 4G's selling points. We have minimal branding to the sides, and this here, it's the 4GB RAM, 128GB storage variant. So now, let's cut through the plastic wrap. And ooh, this actually reminds me, is this the monster Samsung's been targeting? I mean, they've had this entire meanest monster campaign for the last M series phone, the M51, if I can recall correctly. Do you think it was directed at this particular monster? I mean, till this moment, I did not make that connection. What do you think? Coincidence? Maybe not. Anyway, moving on, let's open up the box. We first have this little white insert, and this one has the SIM ejector tool, a regular leaflet, in Chinese of course, since this phone as of now is only available in China. We then have a soft TPU case. Let's now get to the main event, this beautifully blue Redmi Note 9. And no, that is not the official naming. We're not doing sort of Sage, that kind of Google kind of naming. Beautifully blue does sound nice. Anyway, turning it on, and let's now peel the stickers of the back. This plastic back, I mean, it kind of does remind me of the Realme C3. Is it just me, or do you guys see it too? The resemblance. Now, getting back to the main box, this has a USB Type-C cable and an 18-watt charger. Now, do note that the Note 9 launching in India, the one that launched in India, it had a 22.5-watt charger. So this seems to be an area of regression. But the battery capacity though, that has gone up substantially. The Redmi Note 9 4G, it's got a 6000 mAh battery compared to 50-20 mAh on the Indian version. So that's a solid 20% improvement. Now, this build is not something I'm gonna call an improvement. It's not particularly better than the Indian version. Not exactly, but I did like how this bag does not pick up fingerprints or smudges anymore because of that matte Realme C3-esque finish. And dimension-wise, it's still the same, almost exactly the same length and breadth, I mean, even the weight, which is impressive given the increase in battery capacity. The thickness though, it's gone up a little, understandable given the change. Now, the Redmi Note 9 4G, it's still a phone you're gonna need two hands to use more often than not. I mean, the grip is noticeably better, but it's still a large phone. Now, there is a change to the front too, the Redmi Note 9 4G. It has a similar 6.53 inch Full HD Plus panel. Yes, it's still 60Hz, it's IPS LCD, but technically, it's not the same panel because this one's not quite as bright. And more importantly, instead of the punch hole, we now get a notch again. There is also some noticeable brightness loss with the viewing angles and the protection Redmi's used. They've gone from Gorilla Glass 5 to Gorilla Glass 3 here. So quite a few steps back, though not immediately noticeable on paper. The placements, they remain very familiar, power and volume keys to the right. And this time around, the fingerprint scanner is built into the power key. So what do you guys prefer between these two, a rear scanner or one embedded in the power key? Personally, if you ask me, I kind of prefer the rear scanner. I feel it's easier to unlock the phone when you pull it out of your pocket. That's just me though. What do you think? Leave a comment down below. Now for what it's worth, the side-mounted fingerprint scanner here felt as fast as ever. Can't complain about it. To the left, we still have a dedicated micro SD option. So this is a triple card slot, two SIMs and a micro SD. This is especially good considering the base internal storage has gone up 4x. It's 128 gigs now. This variant that you saw, I mean this 4GB RAM, 128GB variant, this is the base. And guys, the Redmi Note 4G to the bottom, it's got the Type-C port, primary microphone and speaker. Up top, alongside the headphone jack and secondary noise cancelling microphone is yet another speaker. So we've got two on this one and they're pretty loud. And here's something I really loved about this design. Look closely at the speaker up top and you can see that one of these holes, it's got the IR blaster. I almost missed that, and Salim from Salim Baba Technical actually pointed it out to me. So a big thank you to him. And this selfie, it was taken using that 8 megapixel selfie camera, which is down from 13 on the Indian variant. The selfies seem just about okay. In fact, a little soft for my liking, and that's a sin. Okay, I'm not going there. It's nothing to write home about. I remember the Indian Redmi Note 9 faring better. In contrast, the 1080p video, the one that was shot through the selfie camera, it was much crispier. Both the front and rear camera videos capped at 1080p 30, which I can't help but feel disappointed about. Now, talking about the rear camera, we are down to 3 sensors now, no more 2 megapixel macro madness. The other 3 though, they remain the same. So the primary is a 48 megapixel sensor that's paired with a f1.8 lens. And the secondary is an 8 megapixel ultra wide, f2.2 ultra wide. And the third one, it's a 2 megapixel depth sensor. The pictures taken by this camera, they seem to turn out all right. I like the background blur. The depth of field came across as quite shallow, and that's always nice, especially in this price segment. The quality of images themselves also felt impressive, just like the last time around. The ultra wides, they turned out nice too. I feel Xiaomi has optimized the camera software here. We have the same software features like the night mode, portraits, pro mode, etc. But the resulting images, they feel a little more refined. And while on the topic of software, this here is MIUI 12 built on top of Android 10. Given this is the Chinese ROM, there is no Google Play Store, no Google services whatsoever. And there is a crap load of bloat. Many, many pre-installed apps, but it's still MIUI. I do have a dedicated video on what new features MIUI 12 brings to the table. They're all present here, and I'm leaving a card to that video. Do check it out for more information. And you saw how subtly I did this to point to the card. Yeah, so that's a little give this video a thumbs up prompt. So go ahead, give this video a thumbs up. Now the performance seemed okay. There were a few stutters here and there. This is the Snapdragon 662 chip that's replacing the MediaTek Helio G85 that was found on the Indian variant. So 11 nanometers versus 12 nanometer, and that should give this a little bit of an advantage with battery life, theoretically. Of course, that 20% increase in battery capacity is gonna make the huge difference. Now guys, here's the deal. The Redmi Note 8 had a glass back and a Snapdragon 665. So again, a 662 here feels pretty regressive. While it is true that the base RAM has gone up by 33%, 3 to 4 gigs, and the storage by 400%, 32 to 128 gigs, I'd still have liked to see something more powerful. It doesn't matter if it's Moto or Redmi, 665 to 662 is a con. They're almost the same chip, and yes, some brands are marketing the 662 as actually more powerful, but do you think Qualcomm's stupid? If they had a more powerful chip, do you really think they're gonna call it a 662 instead of a 665? What does it do for people's mentality, how people perceive the chip? See, yeah, this is almost a chip as powerful as the 665, but not quite there. It just doesn't make sense when the SoC you use is worse than the one from last gen. In fact, it's quite ridiculous when you compare this with the G85. So what do we have here? In the pros column, we have increased RAM, increased storage, a more grippy, less prone to fingerprint back, a possibly fresh camera array layout, a higher capacity battery, and I guess that's it. Now, under cons, we have worse protection, Gorilla Glass 3 compared to 5, a display that's not quite as bright and also goes back to the notch which we saw on the last gen. We have a slower charger, and by the way, reverse charging was rated at 9 watts on the Indian variant. Now this can reverse charge only at 2.5 watts. We also have weaker internals than even last gen. The loss of one camera sensor, though I don't really give a duck about the macro sensor. Bluetooth has gone from 5.0 to 4.2, so there are quite a few steps back. So the phrase one step forward, two steps back, it makes perfect sense here for the Redmi Note 9 4G. So this phone, it does have one thing going for it though. The 4128 Redmi Note 9 that's sold in India, it sells for 13,500 rupees. This one, the 4128, that's the base, it's launched at 999 yuan in China, a shade over 10,000 rupees. So that pricing, if Redmi ends up launching this in India as say a Redmi Note 9 Qualcomm edition or a Lite edition or something, it might be something worth considering. But it is no improvement over the Indian Redmi Note 9 definitely. So there you have it, my take on the Redmi Note 9 4G. What do you think? Do you agree with my conclusion here? What do you feel? Leave a comment down below and let me know. And with that, we get to the end of this video and it is time for me to bid you adieu. Thumbs up, thumbs down based on whatever you felt about it. Subscribe, turn on notifications by hitting that bell icon if you haven't yet. And thanks a lot for watching. Till next time, my name's Ash. You've been watching C4E Tech and I'm signing off for now. You guys have a great day. Bye-bye.